Okay, let's get started with another session about Android and testing. And maybe let me start with the first question. Who was in Wiebe and Ali's session an hour ago about testing on Android with functional testing on Android? Anybody? Yeah, few. Because Android and testing is quite a big topic. So I really would like to see this session more as a continuation of what they did. So I'm not going to go really in detail about functional testing. What I basically would like to do is talk about the approach we use on my current project. And if you would like to know a little bit more about functional testing and all the available frameworks on Android, I would really urge you to take a look at either the session or the presentation they will put online and so on. So, why Android and testing? Well, I think that maybe we start with another small question. Who here is an Android developer? Who has applications in the Play Store? Quite a few. Well, I think that if we make an application, we put a lot of time and effort in it. I think we would like all our users to react quite ecstatic when they use it. They should be happy to use it. And not only because it's nice looking or it's really fulfilling some kind of problem or question they have, but it should also be really good working well. If your application is crashing all the time, it might be very beautiful, it might be something very useful for the user, but in the end, you will end up with users that get quite fed up with the application and they will not keep using it. And on Android, it's maybe a little bit even more difficult than compared to some other platforms because we have so many devices. We have so many different form factors that we need to work with. If you want to do it well, you should try to adapt your application, whether it's running on a phone and a tablet. But this introduces all these different devices. And I hope that if I talk a little bit about how we solve it on my current project, you will not be an immediate expert, or I cannot say here are three steps, follow them, and you are on your way to happy Android testing. But I hope I can bring over that it's possible to do. And something you shouldn't be afraid of, it's something you're not doing yet and still have to learn. So I work as a consultant. I work for a Belgian company called App Foundry. And we are mobile consultants. We do iOS, Android, and mobile websites. And so as a consultant, I tend to switch clients every few months. So I see quite a lot of projects. I've seen a few projects that weren't going that well, so that's also one of the reasons why I'm interested in testing. And I'm feeling like in Android land, testing is for some people still an unknown subject, so that's also why I would like to do a talk about it. And can give one example. A friend of mine told me recently, only a couple of weeks ago, he's started working at a new client. It's a company that sells stuff, so they make apps to sell whatever they want. And they have a huge customer base, but apparently in some specific circumstances, they had a bug whereby the number formatting went wrong a little bit. And it meant that people all of a sudden were going through the app, they wanted to look at a certain article, and the number formatting was wrong, so the price was super cheap, so people were really buying it in huge quantities. Now, of course, the credit card bill came in for a higher amount, so at that point you get people calling up and saying, I saw a super low price in your app, why am I getting billed such a high amount? That is because they had a bug, and apparently somewhere along the road it had been tested, but not in this specific circumstance, or might be very well possible that they were working on some other screen, and while they were doing that, they broke the number format. And in the end, it ended with that company just saying, okay, client, you saw a low price, so you're going to stick to that price, you're going to honor it. And in the end, that costs cost the company quite a lot of money. So I think if you take the effort of writing tests, if you go one step further, and start thinking about how you can automate all this, it also gives you a very good base to think about typical regression problems and so on. If you have once done the effort of writing an automated test, it's something that can run indefinitely. And when you test people, for instance, at a certain point, they say, oh, I need to click for the 500th time through my first screen. I think it's quite natural that at a certain point, you're not really paying attention that much anymore. So it's very good if you have a computer doing that for you. So basically, testing is a way that you can avoid problems as much as possible, I hope. And also, I have nothing against test people. My current project, work with great testers, but I want to have them look after certain edge cases and so on. I want to have them play, I want to have them, network on and off and whatever. I don't want to have them do like the mundane tasks over and over and over. That's what you have computers for. So if you go to the effort of writing unit tests, you have something that you can automate and you can have a whole battery of computers doing hopefully already a lot of testing so that your testing people can really do like fine edge cases and so on. So, because if you take a look and you try to go through literature, time and time again, we find more or less the same conclusion. Yes, if you go towards writing tests for the application, it will take some time and effort up front. You need to set everything up, maybe it's a new skill that you need to acquire, and so on. But in the end, and I also feel like that from my personal experience, it will always pay off in the end. At a certain point, when you have like good test coverage, you have a lot of automated tests running, it really gives you confidence, for instance, to start working on new features. You have your automated tests that are still checking all the time whether you're not accidentally breaking some other feature that you thought was already done. And in the end, if you take a look at whatever metrics you can find, and this is basically just what I could find with a quick search on Google, but there's a 60 million, you get like 16 million results when you look at what is the cost of fixing defects compared to, well, do you have tests, do you have a testing battery or not? So I really think this is making a case for you should invest that little bit of effort up front to start testing. It will pay off after a certain time. Because really, you don't want to find out when your application appears in Play Store that you have a lot of problems. You really would like to mitigate the problems. Be proactive and try to find them while you're still developing, not while the one-star reviews are pouring in. But who here was an Android developer? I saw quite a few hands. Who here is an Android developer and writes tests? Not so many. Is anybody willing to tell why not? If you're writing, why do you feel you shouldn't write tests? Anybody? Anybody willing to say the excuse you're using? Sure, shout.
Time.
Yeah, that's one we hear quite often. Basically, I think you don't really have time for a big survey, but I think the four biggest excuses I always hear is, first of all, I'm just implementing something trivial. I don't need tests for that. Well, I think if you're doing software development for some time, you know that quite often something that was simple and very trivial in the beginning can grow out to quite a big feature in the end. It's also sometimes we developers have like a hero feeling. Oh, we never make mistakes. For myself, I know that's absolutely not true. So I can't use that excuse. Then tests slow you down to a certain extent. Definitely in the beginning, you need to set up everything. If you don't really know it, or not really confident in the beginning, with writing tests, it will take you some time. But I definitely feel that, and I hope that at the end of this presentation, you will have gotten a feel for it, but it's quite okay. You have quite a lot of tools that help you. And in the end, I feel that I win time by having my tests catching issues and so on that in the old days I used to do at the end of a project. So all in all, I think writing tests is not really slowing me down. And then the fourth one I hear quite often, and it's a difficult one, if your company, your team, or your management is not convinced, that's a tough one. I hope that either through some experiences from other people, or if you start small, that you maybe can convince them. That's a difficult one. Now, before I dive into some code and like the setup for our projects, I would just like to talk about what are the typical characteristics, I think, or the traits of a test. I think tests should be isolated, so it shouldn't be possible that if one test is running, another one is running, if you switch the order or whatever, something goes wrong. That's something you really need to take into consideration. All tests should be isolated. They should also be repeatable. So whoever is running the tests, whether it's a build machine, it's a developer, whatever IDE you're using, I think you should strive for a setup where your testing is repeatable and can be done by everybody. And also, speed. Speed is important. I've taken a quick video recording of running the tests in Android Studio for my current project. So you can see here that I run more than 1,200 tests in more or less 14 seconds. And that's good because it's a very short time. I don't really have time to get distracted while the tests are running. And also, when I want to do a commit, I really have no excuse not to run the tests. I mean, it only takes me 14 seconds. So before I send some code to the repository, I should really do this and check if I haven't broken anything, any screen or whatever of the application. I have no excuse. And that's why I think that it's not possible for all the tests. By the end of the application, you will know that this is only a subset of the tests we run. But at least for these 14 seconds wherein I already can run like more than 1,200 tests, it's really something I have no excuses not to do. And also, and that's something a lot of people don't take into consideration, but if you write tests, basically you have written the first part of documentation for your code. I really believe that, like, if you have written unit tests, you basically have written documentation how to use your class. And it's something I do quite often. I hope most of you do. If you have like new API, new library that you need to use, just take a look through the unit tests. It will give you a feel, it will explain how to work with library and so on. So that's one of the other real benefits of taking the effort of writing unit tests, if you ask me. And then other nice to haves is it should be easy to execute. So that means whether you want to run it on a real Android device or you want to work with an emulator or whatever, it should work in both scenarios. For me, very important is you should be able to debug. So if you went to the session by Wiebe and Ali, they showed, five excellent functional testing tools, but for some of them, it's more or less easy to debug. And for me personally, when a tester shows up with a device, and it's always going to be a Samsung device, but when a tester shows up with a device and says, well, something strange is going on with this device, I want to have my tests running on a Samsung device without alteration, and I want to be able to set breakpoints and so on. So they also need to be realistic. Yeah, you need to be able to run on a real device. Otherwise, I'm not really inclined to start using your test library. And by the end of the talk, you will also see that if you say, well, it can take some time and it slows me down, the easier it gets to write the code, so the more fluent the API, for instance, the easier it is and the more your IDE, for instance, can help you do. So when we go through our setup, I hope that you will get a feel for how easy it is to write tests. So really, I and my team, we believe that having a good set of unit tests is really one of the measures for the quality of our project. Now, as an Android developer, let's get a little bit down and let's talk about setup and code. I'm not going to bore you for the rest of the talk with like theory and sorts of tests and whatever. I'm just going to hopefully explain that it's quite easy to do. So let's take a look at some code. And this is what you see if you go to developer.android.com and you start looking for testing. Very quickly, how testing works on Android is you have your application, your tests are going to be bundled in a separate application. And what the testing framework is doing is both of them are deployed on your device. They are run in the same process, so the testing application can instrument your real application. But if you take a look at the site, this is what you're going to see. And don't really focus too much on the code, but it's not really visual, no. And that's why we have like a lot of frameworks that lay on top of the instrumentation testing framework. And what we use is Espresso. So again, if you want to have some more overview, really take a look at the slides from the sessions from last hour. But I have made a very simple demo application. By the way, I've also uploaded it in GitHub because I know that a short session doesn't really give us the time to go over the setup. So if you're really interested in testing on Android, whatever we discuss here, I've made a small demo. You should be able to just import it in Android Studio and play around with it. So that's why I don't focus too much on the code. It's a simple master detail application. Now, whenever you do tests, you will instrument your application. So you will give like comments to say, oh no, take this button, click on it, something should happen, or I have a list, I would like to scroll to the last element, and so on. That's all fine. That's what the instrumentation testing framework can do for you. So your test application can work with the real application. But I think for a good unit test, you don't only have to do stuff with that application, you need to assert, you need to make sure that after you've done all those actions, you need to make sure that your application is in the right state. So that's why I say, don't assume, because you can click on something and it's okay, really assert, really test and check if everything is going well. Now, what you get in the normal Android SDK is quite basic. You get very simple assertions. Everybody that knows the JUnit 3, because unit testing nowadays on Android is still based on JUnit 3, but it is going to change very soon. But you get these and either, well, a few simple view assertions, like you can make sure that your application certain components is on the screen or whatever, but that's basically it. So the first extra library would like to present you and hopefully get you into looking into it is a library that will help you with expressiveness of assertion, and it's called Hempress. And basically that would allow us to write a syntax like assert that audience is paying attention. And you already can feel that this is very fluent. This is something you can read. It's also, by the way, very important if you write unit tests. You're not writing them for yourself. You're writing them for your mates and your team, for your colleagues. So the more readable they are, the easier you make it for the whole team to get in them. So Hempress is the first library I would also urge you to take a look into. And basically, it will allow you to write syntax like assert that, for instance, some string is equal to something you expect. So let's say you have clicked on a button, some data should have been loaded. You remember, always assert at the end of a test. This will really help you out. And it's also something that your IDE can help you out. So this is also very nice to have. It can also help you working with collections in a nice way and so on. Anyway. It's really syntactic sugar, and it's one of the first libraries that we always take with us when we do a setup for Android testing. Because, remember, what we had at the top, this is what we had, like assert equals, and then you have three strings, which one is the actual one, which one is the expected one, which one is the error message. I always get them confused. So this is really where the fluent syntax is very helpful. So, for instance, in my application, I could then write a simple test, say, assert that a certain person, and I'm going to show you the nicer syntax, assert that a certain character assert that a certain collection has my person that I've clicked on, for instance. And it's all feeling very natural. Now, what do you get in a Hempress? You get like quite a nice set of defaults, matches. I would say in this instance, A very nice one is that you can also combine. So you can say, I'm not going to give a list of matches. All of them, or any of them, or one not, whatever, should match. So it's really nice that you can work with combinations too. So for instance, if you write a test on your Android device, here you can see that, for instance, if I want to look for a certain text field, I can say, I'm going to read it out, like, on a view with a certain ID. This is, by the way, espresso code. So you see, that's also a very fluent way of working with your application. So I can say, on a view with an ID, certain text view, check that all of the following matches are valid. And you see that I say it should not start with a certain string, and it should contain another one. So that's really nice. You can do very fine or very intricate or quite advanced matching with the power that's going with Hampcrest. Now, of course, Hampcrest has lots and lots of useful matches, but don't be afraid of writing your own. It's very easy. So this is not a class on Hampcrest. I just want to show you how easy it is. So if you get ever the feeling Hampcrest wants fix or won't cover all my needs, don't be afraid, just write your own matches. So this is a very simple example. Let's say you want to write a matcher to make sure that the square root of minus 1 is not a number. So I would like to be able to say, assert that the square root of minus 1 is not a number. Now, this not a number is not part of Hampcrest by default, so let's just write our own, and again, I'm not going to go too much into code. I just want to show you it's a very small class, and all the magic is in two lines. I basically only say, like, number is not a number. That's a method you have on double in Java. So it's quite easy to do, writing your own custom Hampcrest matches. Now, why am I telling this? Hampcrest is a fine library all by itself, really useful. But it's so useful that it's also part of Espresso. And Espresso is basically the library that Google has released a year ago. It's basically what they see as the library that you should use for functional testing. So it's a layer on top of instrumentation testing, really with the goal of making it easy for you as a developer to work with your application. So you can find views, do stuff with them in a very easy way. Basically, this is a whole API for Espresso on one slide. You find stuff, and then you do stuff with it, or you check. So it gives you very fluent syntax. For instance, you can say things like, on a view with a certain text, perform a click, or on a button with a certain ID, make sure it's displayed on the screen, and so on. So it's a really, really nice framework, and a really nice layer on top of instrumentation testing. It's what we are using now by default. It's also what Google is now using by default. And again, this is a slide by a developer advocate. This is basically the whole API you need to learn, so it's quite easy. Again here, the real power in Espresso is that it is based on Hampcrest matches. So all the knowledge that he had since like 5 minutes about Hampcrest is really getting useful because it's the basis of Espresso. So pretty quickly, you can do view matching. So you try to get a hold of a certain component in your rendered application so that you can work with it. And Espresso has support for all the basic things, like one click or scroll or whatever in your interface, that's all available. Again, since it's based on Hampcrest, now know Hampcrest, you've seen how simple Hampcrest is to work with. Don't ever feel shy or afraid of writing your own actions and assertions. For instance, and it's again, just to show you how little code it is, I would like to be able to, for instance, clear a text field. It's a little bit of a bad example, because of course Espresso can do that, but just to show you, it's all code that is running in a few lines of code. So here, I have made the simplest calculator I could invent. So if I input temperature in degrees Celsius, I would like to get it in degrees Fahrenheit. So at the end, since I've written a custom action, you saw, it did fit on one slide, I can now say on a view with a text Celsius. Again, feel how natural it is to work with your application. Performer, clear text. So this is how easy it is to work with Espresso. And the last remark I would like to make about Espresso is, quite remarkable. It's quite smart, actually. You're, as I said, when you do instrumentation testing, you have your application and the test application that are deployed in the same process on your Android device. That's all working fine until you start doing stuff in the background. So at that point, your testing application doesn't really know, is my application doing something, should I wait? And that's why in the old days, you quite often had like waits and whatever in your testing codes. That's quite nasty code. So what did the Espresso guys do? Basically, they made sure that through their whole setup, and again, if you want to see an example, you can just download it. But like through their whole setup, their test application can be looking into your real application and you can see whether it's idle or still doing work. So you write your tests, you don't really care about, well, a new activity should open up or whatever. You just say, this and this and this and this is what the user would do. This and this and this is what I will do in my text, in my test. And Espresso will make sure that every command is running at the right time. That's very powerful. Only Espresso can't, of course, handle that for all situations. So that's the only thing that you will need to do behind the screens from time to time. Let's say, for instance, you do networking. You do it well, so you do it in the background. It's very well possible that you will need to tell Espresso when you are finished or not. A simple use case, for instance, with an async task, there you are covered. The Espresso guys do the work themselves. But if you, for instance, say you use Retrofit or whatever as a networking library, it's possible that you need to set up yourself. So for that use case, Espresso has an idling resource interface. Again, it's not so difficult. Now, this is basically what we use in my current project to do instrumentation testing. But I showed you like a quick video about having 1,200 tests running in 14 seconds. That will never work that fast when you are really uploading test applications to a real device and communicating. So that's why we use RoboElectric as the second pillar of our test setup. Basically, it's quite a big time sink if you want to do instrumentation testing. The test application, the real application need to be built, need to be put on a device, and so on. Now, if you run normal tests outside of an Android device, this is the error you get. I think most people already have seen it. The Android.jar isn't really a jar because every method will contain an exception saying, I'm just a stop method. It's just to making your IDE and your compiler happy. But behind the screens, of course, an Android device is a combination of Java code and native code, and it's going through to Linux services and whatever. So that's why the normal Android.jar isn't runnable on a normal GVM, so outside of your Android device. So that's why you can use a tool like RoboElectric. So basically, it's shadowing all the Android classes so that you can run your tests outside of a real Android device. That's very powerful, something we use, and it's super fast. For instance, that's why we can run so many tests in such a short time. So for our projects, we really do the combination of both. We have like a big chunk of tests running in a RoboElectric setup. It's super fast, it's working very well, and all the tools you know as a Java developer are available, because in the end, it's just a Java project. And a second part of like more scenario-based testing and so on is what you do in Espresso. The only thing I still want to say about setup, I mean, it's all documented on the site. You have Gradle plugins if you use Gradle. You have Maven plugins if you use Maven. But the setup we go for is something like configure it yourself. By the way, I've included a link to a helpful blog if you want to do that. But basically what you see here is like, this is my Android project, sample project. You see that I have an app, that's your normal Android application, and then at the bottom you see I have something called RoboTests. So this is really just splitting out all my RoboElectric tests from the real Android project, and I find that it's just easier to have everything set up. It's also when something new comes along and greater plugins are up to date, I have it all under my control, and this is the only Groovy code you need to write in your build or Gradle file. So all in all, it's quite easy, and this way I feel I have more control about my whole RoboElectric versus my instrumentation testing setup. Now, the good thing is that if you take a look around on the Google testing blog, and Google also runs a testing conference each year, this is more or less, if you can believe it, the setup that most Android teams inside Google are running to. So they also do a mix of like GVM-based testing. They also use RoboElectric. And then the second pilot, they use Espresso for the instrumentation testing. So that's also, it's working very well for us. And apparently it's working, it's the way of working for most Google Android teams. By the way, full support for JUnit 4 should be coming in the coming months, so that will, again, I hope, make it a little bit easier to have everything set up, and like all the tools you know from regular Java, I should be able to bring them in. Now, quick, another framework I would really urge you to take a look into is a mocking framework, and I'm going to pick one, but there are several ones that work. But basically, when you write tests, let's say you test a class, well, most classes are only useful because they have a lot of other dependencies. You use other classes and so on. But of course, when you write a test, it should be predictable, and it should also be like a very strict test. So if you want to verify behavior of a certain class, most of the times you will want to write tests that you only test your class itself and not the dependencies. So you want to mock away the dependencies. And a good framework for that is Mockito, also because it has support to run on Android. Basically, very quickly for the people that don't know it, I hope I can give you some appetite to check it out. It will make it possible to write a syntax like, I'm just going to read it, basically, when a certain method is called in my test, then return a certain value you have under control. So basically, this is really making sure that your tests test all isolated parts and don't test the dependencies themselves. And also, at the end, you can see that Mockito also has support to verify and so on. Now, another tool is the monkey. It's something we do quite often, quite an evil monkey, because basically it's stress testing the application. This is a tool that you can find in the Android SDK, and it's basically just going loose, it's just doing all kinds of random events, sending them to your application. It's something we run from time to time. So to make sure that weird cases, that you find them during development, and it's basically a really stress testing. It's a command line tool, so you just fire off a command, and it's really sending all these random events. Now, the last of the syntax sugar libraries I wanted to show you is CertJ. It's a library made by the people from Square, and basically it's another library that will help you with a fluent syntax, so I really hope it's more and more all these libraries helping you to be very fast when writing the tests and having an IDE help you. Basically what it's doing is something like this. Android is full of these integer constants, like if you want to set the visibility of a certain component, well, you need to know that you should say fuel.gone, but by the screens, that's an integer and so on. Wouldn't it be nice if you could just say assert that the assert view is gone? And this is the power that you get with assert J. It even gets better because if you have an error in your test, with regular JUnit, you get something like expected 8, but was 4. You don't know what's happening. If you use a tool like assert J, you get something nice and readable like expected visibility gone, but was invisible. So, really helpful tool if you want to write readable tests. Anyway, last topic is then, how can you test networking? I think most applications have networking inside. It's really something that makes it useful. Now, we always split it up in two scenarios. We have like unit tests and integration tests. So let's quickly go through it. What we never do is hit a real server, because we really don't have that under control. Like, your server can be down, or you can be without a network and whatever. So what we do is we swap that out, and we do it in two ways. Either we use a test server, it's something that we have really under control, or we really mock away the networking parts of the application. We do both. So let's quickly go through it, because time is almost up. What you can do if you use a library like Retrofit is, for instance, say, I'm going to mock away, and I'm going to just give back Java code. So let's say if you want to talk to GitHub, you can just say, well, in this test, I'm going to take it under control, and I'm really going to start feeding back my Java objects. That's a very useful thing to do. Now, on the other hand, you're not really testing your HTTP stack if you do that. So let's say you get JSON back. You're not really testing if the JSON deserializing is working well in that case. So for those scenarios, we use a testing server. We use something we have written ourselves, but there are two very good ones. One is Mock Web Server. Again, if you are really interested, you can just download my demo. Basically, you write in Java what your application, what the server should respond for a specific test. Another big one is called WireMock, and this is even better because it has statements also. Let's say you write a banking application, you want to test it if you deposit money. It's really, it didn't appear in your account. This server can have state, or you can script the server to say whatever you need to answer, like in a certain case, an error message and so on. So this is really powerful. It's something you can deploy in your Android application, and this is very nice. So you can say, my Android testing app is running on a device, and bundled with it, you have a testing server that you have instructed what to answer for all the requests. So, that's then most of it. These are the most important parts we have. There's one thing more that I want to show you. It's we use Spoon as a way to instrument this all together. So let's say you have tests, you've done the effort of writing tests. Of course, you want to deploy them on as many devices as possible and as many emulators as possible. We use a tool called Spoon to run them. And so you see, you get a dashboard with the state of all your tests across all your testing devices. And you can also take screenshots with it. So this is really powerful. It's even like very good if you have a designer. You just give him the Spoon dashboard, and he has like a clear overview through your test cases of how the application is behaving and looking. So that's more or less it. If we bring that together, I think most people in the Java space know a tool called like Jenkins. So if you do CI, we do nightly runs, and not only nightly runs, but every time a developer in our team does a commit, we will run the whole test suite across all our devices, and we get a nice dashboard and overview. And the last part is, Android also has support to do coverage. So I think if you write tests, it's very good to know which part of your application you're testing. I mean, you can have written 1,000 tests, but if you're only testing that one button, and you have like 20 other screens, it's not really helpful. So you can use a tool called Yabako, and this is also inside the Android build tools. But that can generate like a nice overview of the coverage you have with your Android unit test. So you see, in my current project, we have like a coverage of almost 90%. So we feel quite confident that we have done like a good effort of writing these tests. So that's basically it. If you would like to have a demo, because this is a lot of frameworks all together and a lot of setup, if you're really interested in Android testing, you can just check out this demo from GitHub. You just import it in Android Studio and everything should be working, and you have like a nice overview of the different methods of testing. So this is a short overview of how we do testing. I think it's for the moment one of the better combinations of all the tools and frameworks and libraries that we have available on Android. The sad part is there's not really books and whatever that will read you. Testing on Android is really something that you will need to spend a little bit of effort on. It's really hunting all those talks and videos and presentations and websites with examples. That's the only difficult part of starting with Android testing, but it's always getting better and better, and Google have announced that they will step up and do quite a better effort for testing. They have announced that they will release an Android support testing library, and that should really make it all easier. So how can you set up? Where do you get all the frameworks? This is something that only can get done. For the rest, testing on Android, testing is quite a well-known subject, and especially in Java. So never hesitate to read like the standard Java books about testing. It's all knowledge that you can apply to your Android testing. That's basically it. If you have questions, I'm going to be around. So I don't think we have time. So if you have a question, just come see me after the session, and we'll be happy to reply. Thanks.